Welcome back. Today we'll see what is Java Virtual Machines Architecture. So to see the architecture, let us get into the diagram. Okay friends, so this is the JVM architecture diagram. So the program that you write will be saved in the .java file, and that .java file is given to the compiler, which is Java C. And the Java C compiler will produce the bytecode, and the bytecode will be saved in the .class file. So this .class file will be given as input into the JVM. As you can see here, there are three modules in the JVM. The first module is the class loader subsystem. The second module is the runtime data areas. And the third module is the execution engine. So JVM is comprising of three components. The first one is the class loader, the second one is the runtime areas, memory areas, and the third one, which is very important, is the execution engine. Execution engine is like the heart of JVM. It is like similar to the CPU of the computer. So execution, all the execution takes place in the execution engine. Now we'll see each and every part and its tasks. What are the tasks that each and every part performs? So we'll take a look at that. So first we'll start with the class loader. So in the class loader, so as you can see, there are three tasks that a class loader performs. The first one is loading, the second one is linking, and the third one is initialization. In loading, you can see there are three class loaders over here. The first one is three types of class loaders. The first one is bootstrap class loader. The second one is extension class loader, and the third one is application class loader. So the class loaders follow certain algorithm, and the algorithm these three class loaders follow is the delegation hierarchy algorithm. The bootstrap class loader is responsible for loading all the files that are there in the bootstrap class path. So the bootstrap class path is like this. So in JDK, so there is a folder called JRE. And inside JRE, there is a folder called lib. And inside lib, there will be rt.jar. This rt.jar includes all core Java APIs. Example, util package, AWT package, lang package, all those things will be there in rt.jar. So bootstrap class loader is responsible for loading all the core Java APIs. And bootstrap class loader is not implemented in Java. It is implemented in the native languages like C and C or C++. The next class loader is the extension class loader. Extension class loader is responsible for loading all the classes that are there in the ext folder. So even in lib, there will be one folder, which is ext folder, and all the classes that are available in the extension folder will be loaded by the extension class loader. And the third one is the application class loader. Application class loader, or this is also called as system class loader. And this is responsible for loading all the classes that are available in the application class path. So application class path is nothing but the current working directory. So, ext is implemented in Java. Whenever JVM needs a class, it requires the class loader subsystem to load the class. So the class loader subsystem requests the application class loader to actually look into the matter. So the application class loader will request the ext class loader, and the ext class loader will request the bootstrap class loader. Because ext is the subset of bootstrap and application is the subset of ext. So they request the bootstrap class loader. So the first bootstrap class loader will look into this bootstrap class path, and if the class is found, it loads. Else it will ask the ext class loader to see in ext folder. So ext class loader will look into the ext folder. If the class is found, it loads. Else it requests the application class loader to load the file. So the application class loader will look in the current directory. And if the class is there, it loads into the JVM. Else what happens is, since the class is not found in the bootstrap class path and in the ext folder and also in the current working directory, then JVM will throw an exception which is called as class not found exception. So this is all about loading. The second phase in the class loader subsystem is the linking. In linking, there are three steps. The first one is verify, and after verify, there is prepare and then resolve. I have written that like the processes are happening one after the other, but this may not be the case. Sometimes all these processes can happen in parallel, in concurrent, or sometimes they happen one after the other. That only depends upon the implementation of the JVM. So let us look into what is verify. So verify is bytecode verifier. So bytecode verifier does two things. The first is it checks whether the bytecode is structurally correct or not. So whether the bytecode is generated properly or not. And the second one is whether it is generated by the compiler. Sometimes there will be illegal bytecodes which will be written by the programmers or hackers, which will exactly look like the bytecodes. So bytecode verifier can make it out whether it is generated by compiler or it is written by some programmer. So whether it is formatted properly or not. So bytecode verifier does this. If it detects that it is an illegal bytecode, then there itself the execution is rejected and it will throw an error which is verify error. Okay, so the next one is after verify, there is another phase in linking which is prepare phase. So what happens in the prepare phase? So in the prepare phase, all the static variables are the class level variables. So these class level variables are taken from the class and they are stored in the method area. So you can see in the runtime data areas, there is one memory area which is method area. So the static variables are stored in the method area. And also the static variables are given the default values. So the default values for the static variables for int it is 0, for float it is 0.0, and for boolean it is false, etc. So all the variables, static variables, are given the default values. So the next phase is the resolve phase. Okay, so what happens in resolve? Okay, so the program that we write is a human understandable program and we'll be using all the day-to-day usage of words, and those symbols are not understood by the machine. So here JVM cannot understand the symbols that we use, like test, the method names that we keep and the class names that we keep. All these the machine cannot understand. So these are considered to be the symbols, and symbols are generally kept in the constant pool. And what happens in resolve phase is these symbols are replaced. So these symbols are replaced by original direct references. What does it mean by original direct reference? Is that it is machine understandable symbols from the method area. So the class is loaded into the method area. So from the method area, it takes the original direct reference and it replaces the symbols with that. So that is called as resolve. Resolve is nothing but replacing the human understandable symbols with the machine understandable symbols. That is called as resolve. So what happens in resolve is the symbols are replaced by original direct references from the method area. Last phase of the class loader subsystem is the initialization. So what happens in initialization? So we have seen that in prepare phase that there will be static variables, and if any, and the static variables are given the default values. Now what happens in initialization phase is that the static variables will be given the values that we have given in the code. So what are the values that we have given for the static variables in the program that we have written? So all those values will be given to the static variables in this particular phase. Not only that, static blocks will be executed. So there will be two things that will be done in initialization phase. The first one is the static variables will be given the original values that we have given in the code. And the second one is that the static blocks will be executed. So this is all about class loader subsystem, my friends. And the class loader subsystem, the purpose of the class loader subsystem is to load the dot class files or the bytecode from the hard disk into the method area. So what is the responsible of the class loader? The class loader loads the dart class files into the JVM. So next we'll see what is the next module. The next module is the runtime data area. As you can see, there are five data areas over here. The first one is method area. The second one is heap area. The third one is stack area. The fourth one is PC registers. And the fifth one is native method stack. So now we'll see each and everything in detail. So what will happen? What will be stored in the method area? So in method area, all the class level information will be saved. All the class level information is stored in the method area. So what is that information? So the information is like the fully qualified name of the class, the immediate parent of the class, and whether the class that we are loading, the dot class file that we are loading, whether it is a class or whether it is enum or whether it is interface, because even for interface dot class file will be generated. So next, the modifiers information and the methods variables information and constructor information and the constants pool, all this will be stored in the method area. So all the class level information, all the class information will be stored in the method area. And also not only that, the static variables will be stored over here. Because static variables are considered to be the class variables. So static variables and all the class information that I told will be stored in the method area. So the next method memory is the heap area. So the heap area, in the heap area, all the objects will be stored. All the objects will be stored. Since arrays are also objects, so arrays also will be stored here. And also the instance variables will be stored in the heap area. Instance variables. Since instance variables are associated with the objects, so instance variables are also will be stored in the heap area. So these two method, these two memory areas are very, very important. And per JVM, there will be only one method area and there will be only one heap area. All the threads that we are talking about will be sharing this method area and heap area. So that is the reason method area and heap area are not thread safe, because all the threads will be accessing this method area and heap area. And this is also your interview question. They'll ask you like, where does the instant variables get stored in JVM? Where do objects get stored in JVM? And static variables, where do static variables get stored in JVM? So this information is very important for you. So the third memory area is the stack area. For each and every thread, there will be a stack created. So there will be a stack. For example, here I showed that there are n threads, and for each and every thread, there is a stack area. So for each and every method call, there will be a stack frame created. So for each and every method call, there will be a stack frame created. And inside each and every stack frame, there will be three informations that will be stored. In each and every stack frame, there will be three information that will be stored. The first one is the local variable array. The second one is, which is called as LVA, and the third one is OS, which is operand stack, and the third one is FD, which is frame data. What will be stored in LVA? LVA is local variables. So all the local variables of the methods will be stored over here. And next is operand stack. Any operations that we are talking about. Okay, so that operations will be stored in the operand stack. Next is frame data. So any exceptions that have arisen during the execution of the methods. So all that kind of exception information will be stored in the frame data. So this is all about the stack area. So what will be there in the stack area? For each and every thread, there will be one stack created. And since for each and every one thread, there is one stack created, it is thread safe, because no threads will go into the other stack. So this is thread safe. This stack area is thread safe. And for each and every method call, there will be a stack frame created. and inside this tag frame this kind of information is stored. So the next memory is that which is PC registers. PC stands for program counter. PC stands for program counter. So what does this program counter have? Okay, so for each and every thread there will be one PC register maintained. So the current working instruction will be there in the PC registers. So the current working instruction is will be there in the PC register. So the next one is, next memory is native method stack. In case in your program if you are using any native methods, so those methods will be stored in the native method stack. And for again this will look like this stack area. So this native method stack also will look like this method area, wherein the native methods, for each and every native method there will be one stack created and all this will happen. So this is all about the JVM memory. So inside JVM memory there will be five parts. First one is the method area, the second one is heap area, third one is stack area, fourth one is PC register, and the fifth one is native method stack. And this is regarding the second module of JVM. So now we'll get into the third module of JVM, and which is very very important module of JVM, where the execution takes place. This is the execution engine. And inside the execution engine there are again three parts over here. The first is the interpreter, the second one is the JIT compiler. JIT stands for just in time compiler. So just in time compiler. And the third one is the garbage collection, and the security manager, and few others also will be here. Whatever is important I have written here. So this is regarding the execution engine. Now we'll see what is the responsibility of the interpreter. Interpreter will take line by line of the code and will start executing. So since it will take line by line, so it will take very long time. That's the reason the performance of Java when compared with the native machines, native languages like C and C++, the performance is a bit slow. So to improve the performance, because that is becoming a drawback in Java. So what they did is in Java version 2, they added JIT to the JVM. So the JIT compiler will actually make or improve the performance of the JVM by actually doing these things. So what does the JIT compiler do? So JIT compiler will take the intermediate code, will give the code to the intermediate code generator. This will optimize the code. So this is code optimizer, and this will produce the target code generator. Target code generator is nothing but the machine code. Okay, so now we'll see what is the drawback and we'll compare. Now what happens in interpreter is, if a method is called again and again, the interpreter will again and again check it line by line. So that is waste of time. So what happens is, when a method is called multiple times, JIT compiler will identify it and it will actually generate the machine code of the method and it will keep it. So whenever this the method is called again, so rather than interpreting it again, what will happen is this machine code will be replaced. So that is how the performance of Java is improving. So the next one is garbage collection and security manager. Garbage collection, Java has got automatic garbage collection. So unreferenced objects are generally removed by the JVM rather than the programmer doing it on his own. So the security manager will decide on what resources the class have to access. Okay, and the next is the native Java native interface, which is JNI. So if the during execution if JVM requires any of the native methods, okay, so it will request the JNI to actually get the methods and give it to the engine. So that's the use of JNI. So JNI will get the native methods and it will give to the execution engine if it requires any. So we'll see what is a profiler. So the profiler is also called as hotspot. Okay, so because the profiler will identify for the hotspots in the code. That is, I already told you that if a method is called many times, the interpreter will be executing it again and again. So that is making JVM slow. So now to improve the performance of the JVM, now the profiler will identify the hotspots in the code, meaning that the method that the JVM spends more time on. And those kind of methods will be identified by the profiler and they will be given to the JIT. And then all these things will happen in the JIT, and then finally the machine code will be generated for the hotspot methods. Okay, so this is all about the JVM architecture, my friends. And one very important thing that you need to remember is JVM is platform dependent. Platform dependent. Meaning that if you want to run the code on Windows, you need JVM specific to Windows. If you want to run the code on Linux, then you need JVM specific to Linux. So this is all about JVM architecture. Hope this video is helpful to you, my friends. Stay home, stay safe. Watch my upcoming videos for lectures on Code Java. Happy learning. Bye.